Hello students, today we are going to study about chapter The Fundamental Units of Life. First paragraph of this chapter tells us about discovery of cell. Because see, till 1665 nobody knew what our bodies, what are organisms made up of. They knew about organs, but what are organs further made up of, nobody knew. Robert Hooke was inquisitive. He wanted to know what organisms are made up of, so he designed his own microscope, and he cut very very thin sections of the slices of bark of the tree, which we call cork. This can be asked for 1 mark. That's what is cork. It's a substance that comes from bark of a tree. So, and he could see honeycomb like structures in which he could see only the lines, only the cell walls, but he could not observe the inner living substance of cell. Since he could see only the empty spaces, he thought the cell is a compartment. So he gave a Latin word that is little room or compartment. But this term is a misnomer. Why it is misnomer? It's not appropriate. It's not at all appropriate, right? Because see, like there is a beggar, you know, and we call him Karodi Mal. So that would be a misnomer. And suppose there is one sage, and his name is Bihari Das. So that's a misnomer, right? So same way, this term cell is misnomer, but just to acknowledge the hard work done by this pioneer Robert Hooke, we are using this term cell even today. All right. So next we come to next this activity. What are living organisms made up of? This you will also do in your practical, in your laboratories. We take a small piece from onion bulb with the help of pair of forceps. We take this peel. A very thin peel from concave side of onion. So on this side there is a very very thin transparent structure that we separate from this slice of onion bulb, and then we shall be putting it in water so that it doesn't get folded or it doesn't get dried, because otherwise we shall not be able to see the detail. And then we keep a glass slide, we put a drop of water and transfer this very small piece, piece of peel. Generally, we take a rectangle piece of peel that we are keeping on a glass slide in the center. And then we put a stain, that is safranin stain. Safranin is, it will give pink color. Why do we stain cells? Because cells will appear, transparent below microscope. Just to give different colors to different components, we are staining so that when cells get dyed in a contrast way, we are able to see this clearly. And then on this peel, we keep another, after safranin, we put a drop of glycerin, and then we put another very, very thin piece of glass, that is cover slip. One precaution we have to take while keeping the cover slip, that it should be kept very, very slowly to avoid entry of air bubbles. And one more precaution while transferring this peel from the wash glass, we use paint brush so that cells are not damaged. And with the help of paint brush, we unfold the peel, because peel should not be folded, otherwise clarity will not be much. Right. And when we observe this microscope slide under the microscope. This is compound microscope, and it's made up of eyepiece lens, because here we are seeing through this lens. Then this side is objective lens. This is stage on which we are keeping our slide. So here we are keeping our slide. Then this is a coarse adjustment. This is a fine adjustment. First of all, we are using coarse adjustment. Coarse adjustment jo hai, wo is tube ko upar niche karne mein help karti hai. So this coarse adjustment focuses the slide. And then here is a reflector. The reflector will focus light. This light will fall on it, and then this light will be reflected up so that we are able to see this light. This is heavy base, right? So this is structure of microscope. When we observe our onion peel under this microscope, we shall be able to see structures like this. But the difference is that this diagram is given in sky blue color, and we shall be able to see in pink color when we are using saffron and stain. What we'll be observing under compound microscope when we are making our slide and observing it, we shall be able to see this, cell walls. This is the cell wall. And the nucleus. And these, nucleus and cell wall will be darkly stained, and they will be very light stained cytoplasm. So very light cytoplasm. So this is how we will be observing onion peel cells. Now we proceed to next part of it. And one thing to be noticed is all cells are alike. So this was making or preparing temporary mound of onion peel. So he says, what are these structures? The structures that we saw are the cells. And this paragraph will make you clear that onion bulb may be of different sizes, maybe small, maybe big, but all cells are of same size. Only difference will be bigger onion bulbs will have more number of cells, and small onion bulb will have less number of cells. And then comes this yellow box. Yellow box is history of cell. This is very important. So cells were first discovered by Robert Hooke in 1665. He observed cells in a cork slice with the help of a primitive microscope. So this we have done. Now comes Leeuwenhoek. Leeuwenhoek was a draper. He was a merchant. He was a draper, but again, he had keen interest in life sciences. In 1674, he observed the first living cell. Robert Hooke observed first dead cells. He observed first living cell in pond water for the first time. The third is Robert Brown. In 1831, see the difference of time, 1674, till 1831, more than 100 years. It took so more than another 200 years. More than 100 years. So Robert Hooke discovered nucleus. Then was Purkinje. Purkinje coined the term protoplasm for the living substance of the cell. Say this is a cell membrane. Whatever is filled inside is protoplasm. This is basically cell plus nucleus. Cell cytoplasm plus nucleus is protoplasm, right? And after that comes the cell theory. This is very important, but don't be scared. You will not be getting so many names, in the later part of the chapter. Cell theory says, first postulate of cell theory is that all plants and animals are composed of cells, and the cell is basic unit of life. This was presented by two biologists independently, Schleiden and Schwann. One of them worked on plants, another worked on animals. Cell theory was expanded by another scientist known as Virchow. Virchow in 1855, usne ek statement di. He gave a statement, "Omnis cellula e cellula." Omnis cellula e cellula means all cells arise from pre-existing cells. We cannot create new cells in the laboratory. We can just manipulate a little bit, but we cannot create new cells. So all cells are formed by division of pre-existing cells. Then with the discovery of electron microscope in 1940, here also one more question can be asked. When was electron microscope observed? So electron microscope enabled us to understand complex structures and cells and various organelles, right? So this was all about discovery of cells. Then it says invention of magnifying lenses led to discovery of microscopic world. It is now known as a single cell. Now here you can give heading to this paragraph, unicellular versus multicellular organism. A single cell You can mark from here. A single cell may constitute entire whole organism, as in case of amoeba and paramecium, chlamydomonas. So we have got examples of unicellular organisms. So amoeba, paramecium, bacteria, chlamydomonas. Right. These are called unicellular organisms. On the other hand, many cells group together in a single body, assume different functions in it to form various body parts in multicellular organisms. So examples of multicellular organisms are fungi, plant and animals. Right. So this is about unicellular versus multicellular. Then comes, we can prepare temporary mounds of leaf peels, tip of roots and onion, or even peels of onion of different sizes. There are some questions. Do all cells look alike in terms of shape and size? No. Do all cells look alike in structure? There can be little differences. Could we find differences among cells from different parts of the plant body? What similarities? There are some similarities, some differences. Some organisms can also have cells of different kinds. Look at the following picture. So here we have smooth muscle cells. It has spindle shaped. So there are circular blood cells, elongated nerve cell, very, very swollen fat cell. There are irregular bone cells. Then we have ovum, which has a lot of food stored in it, and then elongated sperms. So it means cells can be of various structures, various size and various shapes. Now here in this paragraph it comes, what are the factors on which shape and size of cells depend? Shape and size of cells are related to specific function they perform. Some cells can change their shape. So name the cells that can change their shape is amoeba. In some cases, cell shape could be more or less fixed and peculiar for a particular type of cell. For example, nerve cells have a typical shape, and this shape helps in transmission of nerve impulses. Each living cell has capacity to perform certain basic functions, which are characteristics of living form. How does a living cell perform these basic functions? Yes, now comes important thing, division of labor. What is division of labor? Now, say children, in case school may, like your principal is handling, she's in charge of all the activities going on in your school. Then administrative block is handling administrative task, teacher is handling teaching, students are handling studying, workers are handling cleaning and maintenance of lawns and garden of the school. Sports teachers are handling games activity. Every person is given a task, is assigned a task. Similarly, in our body, like different parts of human body perform different function. Human body has a heart to pump blood, a stomach to digest food and so on. Similarly, division of labor is also seen in cell. In each cell, there are certain specific components known as organelle. Each organelle performs a specific function, such as making new material in the cell, clearing up waste material, and so on. So cell is able to live and perform all the function because of this organelle. So organelle together constitute the basic unit known as cell. So here you can give heading, how does division of labor take place in case of cells? Right. Now, so all cells are found to have same organelle, no matter what their function is or what organisms they are, organism they are made up of, they are found in. So here are two questions. First one we have already done. Second one also in a part we have done. Why cell is called structural and functional unit of life? Because every organism is made up of cells. This is what our cell theory says. And functioning of body is sum total of functions of organisms. So cell is functional unit also. Now, what is cell made up of? Second part, what is cell made up of and what is structural organization of cell? We saw here, if we study a cell under a microscope, we would find that there are three features which are common to all the cells. So this is another one mark question. Three features which are common to all the cells are plasma membrane, nucleus, cytoplasm. So these are the features which are common to all the cells. Now we come to plasma membrane or cell membrane. Plasma membrane or cell membrane, this is outermost covering of cells. This is the outermost covering which separates the content of the cell from external environment. So it maintains identity or individuality of the cell. Plasma membrane allows or permits entry and exit of some materials in and out of the cell. Like in your homes, you do not allow every person to enter your home. Only the selected people are able to enter. So your house, the gate is semi-permeable. You are not permitting all to come. Some can come, some cannot. It also prevents movement of some other material. So cell membrane is called selectively permeable membrane. It allows entry of few material, but not all. Then comes next part. Some substances like carbon dioxide and oxygen. So question here can be, how do gases like carbon dioxide and O2 move across the cell membrane? There is a process known as diffusion. Now, so there is a spontaneous movement of a substance from the region of higher concentration to region of lower concentration. This is known as diffusion. So this is definition of diffusion. Spontaneous movement of a substance from a region of high concentration to region of low concentration. Then comes next paragraph. How does carbon dioxide moves into or out of the cell? Or rather, better will be out of the cell. Now, okay. So there is a, you know, in-text question also that we are going to answer now. So some substances like carbon dioxide, which is a cellular waste and required to be excreted, it accumulates in high concentration inside the cell. Because in the cell, that respiration process is going on, which is that glucose combines with oxygen to give carbon dioxide, water and energy. So this CO2 is accumulated in the tissue, which is to be thrown out. In the cell's external environment, concentration of CO2 is low. Inside the cell, it is in higher concentration, outside is less. So gases will move from higher concentration to lower concentration, right, by the process known as diffusion. Similarly, oxygen enters the cell by the process of diffusion. Say when we are inhaling, say this is one lung alveoli. Here, oxygen will be high because we are inhaling fresh air. And this is our blood capillary, which has less of oxygen. It has less oxygen and lung alveoli has more oxygen, right? So now oxygen will move from higher concentration to lower concentration. Now CO2, since this blood has come from the tissue, so it has rich in CO2. And here in our lung alveoli, CO2 will be less, because atmospheric air has less CO2. So carbon dioxide will move from blood to lung alveoli, right? So this is how gases are transported, sent out of the cells or inside the cells. So diffusion plays an important role in gaseous exchange between cells as well as cell and external environment. So from last line also question can be asked, how? So this statement can be given and then they'll write, explain. Now we come to next part, a special form of diffusion, that is in which only the solvent molecules move. This is now termed as osmosis. In osmosis, movement of water across plasma membrane is affected by amount of substances dissolved in water. So sometimes, like say this is one vessel which is separated by a semi-permeable membrane. And now this semi-permeable membrane will have small pores. Right. Now, one side we have sugar and other side sugar solution. And other side we have water, plain water, right? So water can sugar molecules, so this is plain water, sugar molecules will not be able to move through these pores. So what will happen? To equalize the concentration, some of the water will move in this sugar side. So what will happen? The level will increase here and water will decrease this side. So here movement of water molecule is going on from lower concentration to higher concentration. This type of process in which water moves from region of high water concentration to region of low water concentration through a semi-permeable membrane is called osmosis. Children, if you do not write osmosis in the definition will be incomplete. All right, now we come to next part of it. All of you have observed osmosis in your day-to-day life. Now, first case is if medium surrounding cell has a higher water concentration than the cell, meaning outside solution is very dilute, cell will gain water by osmosis. This type of solution is known as hypotonic. Now, what does it mean? Say this is a cell and outside, say it is water and the cell is basically, suppose we can say raisins or kishmish. Right. Now, when we are soaking raisins in water, what happens? Raisins are dried grapes. When you look at this, you will see very wrinkled structure. When we soak this in water, this swell up. And if we taste outside water, outside water will not be sweet. It means sugar has not come out of raisins, but water has gone from outside to inside. So sugar molecules are more inside. So water will move in to equalize the concentration. So some molecules of water may move out, but net movement of water will be inside. So this is known as end osmosis. Due to end osmosis, raisins will swell up. Any cell when kept in hypotonic solution, outside will be hypotonic. When concentration of solute is lesser, we call it hypotonic. Now here concentration of sugar is more, we call it hypertonic. A hypo and hyper are always relative terms. So when we are keeping cell in hypo, HYPO, less concentration, HYPER, 5, so more concentration. This is just to remember, a shortcut to remember. Now next case comes, second one. If, suppose we take a cell and it has same concentration of salt inside as well as outside. Say we have taken 0.7 gram of water in 100 ml of water, and here also it is 0.7 gram per 100 ml of water. Then water molecule, see, there is equal concentration. Now water molecules will keep on moving in and out, but there will be no net movement in one particular direction. The cell will neither swell up nor it will shrink. So this type of solution is known as isotonic solution. Now comes next part. On the other hand, third case, if we are keeping our cell in highly concentrated solution, that is concentration of salt is more outside. Just imagine when we are cutting salad, situation. There is no water in it. But if we sprinkle some salt, after some time, we'll say in the salad plate, 1 spoon or 2 spoons of water, it accumulates. From where has that water come? This is from the raw vegetable or fruits. When we are sprinkling salt, then what happens? Say we take a piece of cucumber and we have sprinkled some salt over it, and this salt will dissolve in the moisture of the cucumber and it will form hypertonic solution, right? And so the cells of cucumber will lose water due to osmosis and then in turn will shrink. Right. If we there are there, you know, on these hypotonic, isotonic, and hypertonic solution, you can be asked reason based question. Suppose what will happen if excess of fertilizers are sprinkled on the grass? The grass will dry up because excess of fertilizers will dissolve to form hypertonic solution, and cells of grass will lose water and will in turn dry up. Then, like in case of pickle, you know, when I make pickle, or say mango pickle or any other vegetable pickle, I add lot of quantity of salt in it, and I fill the jar. And still, if some vegetables are left, I will pick, I'll keep those say raw mangoes mixed with all spices and salt in separate vessel. And the jar is filled, and I just keep it as such. And next day, next morning, when I get up, there is in the jar, which was filled up till brim the previous night, now it has a lot of space. How come that space has been created now? Because the raw mangoes will ooze water, so reduce in volume, because these will shrink due to osmosis. So space is created, right? So it's clear about now hypotonic, hypertonic, and isotonic solution. Now here is the activity. Osmosis with an egg. In this case, what we have to take is, we will be taking one egg and we put it in a beaker containing dilute hydrochloric acid or any other acid. Normally we take HCl only. Now the shell of the egg is made up of calcium carbonate. It will dissolve with acid to form calcium chloride and carbon dioxide and water. This carbon dioxide will ooze out. Now this shell will dissolve, and inside will be now, the cell will have, this shell will dissolve, and inside you will be able to see, let me tell you, okay. Inside now, plasma membrane will be visible. Cell will become the egg will become very soft. Now you transfer this egg in water. Now, egg has some salt content in it. Outside is water, so water will form hypotonic solution. Water always moves from hypotonic to hypertonic solution, so endosmosis will take place. As a result, egg will swell up. On the other hand, if we transfer this cell in highly saline solution, where salt concentration is a lot, then the cell will shrink, because now outside salt content is more, water content will be comparatively less, and here salt content will be lesser. So water will move from inside of the egg to outside to equalize the concentration, and egg will shrink. And then next activity is again, raisins that I've already explained to you, raisins or apricots. We can show osmosis with the help of raisins or apricots. Now, unicellular freshwater organisms and most cells tend to gain water through osmosis. And absorption of water by plant roots is also an example of osmosis. So this is significance of osmosis. Then comes diffusion is important in exchange of gases and water in life of cell. In addition, cells also absorb nutrition from environment by diffusion. And then till here is diffusion. Now from here, different molecules move in and out of the cell through a type of transport system which uses energy. So this uses energy in the form of ATP. And this type of transport is known as active transport. Active because it uses energy. Basically, there are three mechanisms, three processes that take place when there is transport of material across cell membrane. This is diffusion, osmosis, and active transport. Active transport is not explained much in your book. Now we come to next part, flexibility of cell membrane. This is important for your exam. Flexibility of cell membrane we skipped here. The plasma membrane is flexible and is made up of organic molecules called lipids and proteins. So one more question, what is plasma membrane made up of? Right. Now, flexibility of cell membrane also enables cells to engulf in food and other substances from its external environment. Such a process is known as phagocytosis or endocytosis. Now, say this is amoeba. When food approaches, amoeba forms pseudopodia around it, and which will cover food from all the sides. And in this process, it creates a cell, a food vacuole. Now, this is a vacuole pinched off from plasma membrane, and inside is food. So some enzyme will be released in this food vacuole from cytoplasm. This food will be digested, and the digested content will move out, and inside will be left the residual body, which cannot be digested. And then here, the residual body will, this residual vacuole will come near plasma membrane, and then residual body through the plasma membrane will be released out. So this intake of food takes place. This is known as endocytosis. Endo means under, interior. Cytosis, cyton. To take something inside the cell is endocytosis. Amoeba acquires its food through such process, right? So now, now comes cell wall. Plant cells, in addition to plasma membrane, have another rigid outer covering called cell wall. Cell wall lies outside plasma membrane. So this is the second point. Now, plant cell is mainly composed of cellulose. Cellulose is a polymer. Cellulose is a polymer of glucose. Large number of glucose units, they combine together to form cellulose, and cellulose forms cell wall. It's a complex substance, and what is the function of cellulose? It provides structural strength to the plants. Now, this is very, very important. When a living cell loses water through osmosis, so to be focused here, living plant cell loses water through osmosis, there is shrinkage or contraction of the contents of cell away from cell wall. Say this is cell wall, and then inside like that. Now inside is vacuole. Here is nucleus. When this plant cell is kept in hypertonic, when a plant cell is kept in hypertonic solution, very high concentration of salt, this will lose water. Now what will happen? There will be shrinkage of the content. Entire cell, the plasma vacuole will reduce, cytoplasm will shrink. So this is the plasma membrane now, this is cell wall, this is nucleus. This stage is known as plasmolysis, and the cell is plasmolyzed, right? And when we add water, more, now this transfer this cell in plain water, again this cell will absorb water and will gain its original form. Now, last topic for today is this activity. Mount peel of rhodiola leaf in water on slide and examine cells under high power of microscope. We can see small green granules called chloroplast, which contain chlorophyll. We shall be discussing about chloroplast in the cell organelle part. Put a strong solution of sugar or salt on the mounted leaf of slide. What will we see? The cell is plasmolyzed. Now, put some rhodiola leaves in boiling water. This kills the cells. Now mount one leaf on a slide and observe under microscope. Put a strong solution of sugar and salt on the mounted leaf. What will you observe? Will you observe plasmolysis? No. Because I told you in the previous paragraph when I was telling you about plasmolysis, when a living cell, plant cell, if you remember, when a living plant cell loses water, right, by boiling, cells will be dead. Right. So dead cells will not absorb water by osmosis. They will not show the and show any change. Water will not move in or out. Now, cell wall, function of cell wall, it permits cells of plants, fungi and bacteria. You can be asked, name three groups of organism which contain cell wall. It's plant, fungi and bacteria. They can help cells to withstand very dilute hypotonic external media. Ab cell ko rakh diya humne hypotonic mein. Sir, wahan pe kya hoga? Cell will keep on absorbing water and it will swell up and ultimately it may burst. But if cell has cell wall, cells cannot burst because the internal turgor pressure, when equalizes the cell wall pressure, then there will be no more intake of water molecule. Though there can be like osmosis, but now osmosis will stop because cell wall is very rigid, that cannot expand much. It can just expand slightly. It's not elastic. So because of cell walls, these cells, they can withstand much greater changes in the surrounding medium than cells. So children, this is about this lesson till cell wall. In the next video, we will be covering remaining part of this lesson. So till then, happy learning and thank you so much.